16.6 refers to really the stereochemistry of conjugated dienes. So if I want to think about if I have a conjugated diene, like so, I need to look at the stereochemistry of each alkene individually. So I have several possibilities. So if I look here, this alkene is E, and this one is E. So I can have an EE, or trans-trans, if you want. I can have my conjugated diene where it's Z. This one's Z. Okay, so sum them together. And this one is Z. Or I can have it mixed, where one of them is Z, and one of them is E. And then we often also want to look at the rotation of the sigma bond that connects the two pi bonds. Because there's free rotation around that, there's two possible conformations that can happen. So if I just take a simple compound, like butadiene, this can either be rotated so that these are sort of apart from each other, or it can be rotated so that they're near each other, or sort of on the same side. And what we call this is we say that this one is an S-trans, because it's only a sigma bond, okay, and there is free rotation, but there's sort of a trans stereochemical relationship between the two alkenes, and we call this an S-cis conformation, because the two alkenes are cis to one another when you look at them compared to the sigma bond. Now there's a continuing theme that we're going to want to look at about stability and how we actually know any of the things that we know about what's more stable, whether a conjugated diene is more stable than an isolated diene, whether a certain type of radical, a secondary radical, is more stable than a primary radical. And what it all comes down to is really the energy difference between two molecules. And to figure that out, we need to somehow be able to form a same molecule and then compare the difference in energy between the starting material and the product. In this case, we're going to look at a heat of hydrogenation. A conjugated diene, if I treat that with H2, palladium on carbon, we'll get the alkane. And if we take the isolated diene, treat that with the same H2 and palladium on carbon, we actually get the exact same product. In both cases, we get pentane. Since we get the same product in both cases, now we can directly compare the energies of them. When we look at the conjugated diene, the energy of this reaction is minus 226 kilojoules per mole. Remember, we've got extra sigma bonds and less pi bonds, so the energies went down. The product is more stable than the reactant. And if I look at the isolated diene, the energy difference is minus 255 kilojoules per mole. So more energy is given off when we do this reaction. So if we want to look at these all together, here at the bottom is your pentane, and up 226 kilojoules per mole from that, if this is energy, on the y-axis, we have the conjugated diene, and up from that, up 255, we have the isolated diene. So now what we can do is we can directly compare these two and say the difference here between these is 29 kilojoules per mole. So you can say that the conjugated diene is 29 kilojoules per mole more stable than the isolated diene. Section 16.10, we'll look at electrophilic addition, and let's look at the difference between an isolated diene and conjugated diene. So if I have an isolated diene, 1,4 pentadiene, and I add HBr, go through the standard mechanism, electrons come out from the alkene to the proton, this bond breaks and the electrons go onto bromine. That should be second nature for you by now, I hope. You have to decide where you're going to put your proton versus where you're going to put your positive charge. Notice the two choices that we have are the one where you have a secondary carbocation or where you have a primary carbocation. And this is not conjugated, however. Okay, there's an sp3 carbon right here in between. So this is not an allylic position. So it's just the standard. You're looking at a secondary versus a primary carbocation. The secondary is better. So in the second step, the bromide adds, and you get this product. Now you can do the same thing with the other alkene, but this molecule is symmetrical. There's a plane of symmetry here, right down the middle. So you get the exact same product. So there's really only one product of this reaction. Now if I look at the exact same reaction with the conjugated diene, I get my proton to add, and I get my intermediate, but now my intermediate allyl. Remember, this isn't just secondary, this is an allylic carbocation. So I actually have that, and I have this electron pair can move over to form the resonance structure, which would look like this. Okay, so now I have two different resonance structures, and remember, it's not going back and forth, it's both of them at the same time. So when the bromide adds, there are two possible places it can add. So it can add to this first place, and if you look at where the H is and where the bromine is, they're next to each other, so this is called a 1-2 addition. The proton adds first in the one position, and then the bromide adds in the second position, one position away from that. And this one, the bromide adds over here, and the proton that we added was over here. So now this one is 1-2-3-4. This is called a 1-4 addition. So there's two different products here. There's a 1-2 addition product and a 1-4 addition product. So the next thing we need to sort of think about is how do we get each of the different products? When does each one form?